Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, or ever thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. Thou turnest man to destruction, and sayest, Return ye children of men. For 1,000 years in thy sight are but yesterday. The days of our years are 70. And if by reason or by strength there be 80, yet is there strength and labor and sorrow, for it is soon cut off, and we fly away. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts unto wisdom. Man is born of a woman, is of a few days, and full of trouble. He cometh forth like a flower, and is cut down. He fleeth also as a shadow, and continueth not. If a man die, shall he live again? All the days of my appointed time will I wait, till my change come. Thou shalt call, and I will answer. Thou wilt have a desire to the work of thine hands. Let us bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, we have come from the north and the south, the east and the west. We have come from different states and different cities. We have come, God, to stand with the family of Elder Crowe in solidarity, to be with them and to mourn with them and to support them in this time of grief. Father, we just pray that you will anoint this service with your Holy Spirit, that your Holy Spirit tonight will bring comfort to those who need comfort, hope to those who need hope, courage to those who need courage. And so, Father, take control of this service. Be with the family, bless them, and comfort them, is my prayer. In the name of Jesus and for his sake, amen. Please be seated. On the behalf of Riverside Chapel, Seventh-day Adventist Church in Nashville, and on behalf of the Elder Crowe's family, we want to welcome all of you who have come here to stand in solidarity with the family and to be a support to them. We welcome you. But we also welcome you in coming here to celebrate a life and a legacy that has been left by Elder Crowe. And we pray that as you go through this service, that not only will you bring comfort to the family, but that you will also be blessed just because you are here. Turn to your programs. We have one slight adjustment. Our Old Testament scripture was to be given by Chaplain Washington Johnson. However, he was unable to come. And so tonight, our Old Testament scripture and our New Testament scripture will be brought to us by Elder Benjamin Jones, President of South Central Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. And then it will be followed by Dr. Janice Johnson Brown, a special music selection given by her.
Before I read the scripture, I want to say on behalf of the South Central family, we share your loss. I've been in South Central for 47 years. And when I came, Elder Crowe was my treasurer, my mentor, a wise man, a great man, a true pioneer for the regional conferences. And he is going to be deeply missed. The Lord promised 70 and blessed him to go way beyond that. So I'm glad to call him my friend. One of his favorite texts is Psalms 23. For the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores and keeps on restoring my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, and your rod and your staff, they give me comfort. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup just keeps on running over. Surely now, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell finally in the house and in the presence of the Lord forever. And then there's the promise of John 14. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you one day may be also. May these words bring your soul comfort this night.
Give me Jesus. come to die. Oh, when I come to die, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus.
Amen. Don't we need Jesus? Give me Jesus. Thank you, Dr. Brown. At this time, we shall have our acknowledgments, after which we invite you to read the obituary silently while accompanied by music. And then after that, we shall have our words of comfort.
Resolution of respect for Frederick Nathan Crowe. We, the entire membership of the Riverside Chapel Seventh-day Adventist Church, extend to the family of Elder Frederick Nathan Crowe our heartfelt sympathy in the loss of your loved one. Whereas Frederick Nathan Crowe passed from this life on Thursday, November 29th, 2018, and whereas the death of Elder Fred N. Crowe does not diminish the profound benediction of a life lived in such a godly service, nor our admiration of the affection for Elder Crowe's example, and whereas in his service as minister of the gospel for over 70 years, he shared as well an exuberant, steady spirit and compassionate heart. And whereas our beloved Elder Crowe embraced the all-forgiven presence of God from his earliest days and strove to exhibit the same qualities of compassion throughout an exemplary and blessed life. And whereas the family and acquaintances of Frederick Nathan Crowe are deeply saddened at his departure, as are all who were touched by his kind spirit and generosity. And whereas Elder Crowe's legacy of faith and service will continue to inspire his loved ones and every member of the Riverside congregation. Whereas, in the providence of God, after 104 years, he has brought to close the life of Fred N. Crowe. According to his tender mercy, God, who is infinite in his wisdom, makes no mistakes. God knows each one of his children. He knows how much we can bear. Psalm 30, verse 5 tells us, his anger endureth but a moment. In his favor is life. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. Whereas the passing of our beloved friend and father has left us with a broken heart, we acknowledge and we accept the will of God. We know our hearts bleed with sorrow, but we are comforted by the hope that the great getting up morning when our Lord and Savior shall return. Therefore, be it resolved that we embrace the Crowe family, because all of us have a common bond that will connect us for the rest of our lives. Therefore, be it resolved that we embrace the Crowe family, because all of us have a common bond. And be it further resolved that Frederick Nathan Crowe will be missed by the Riverside Church family, but we expect to see him in the kingdom. May the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Humbly submitted, Riverside Seventh-day Adventist Church, Furman F. Fordham, the second senior pastor, Christopher Marshall, associate pastor.
this time we shall begin with words of comfort to the family. And I consider this document that you have in your hand a living document. In other words, it could change at any time. Unfortunately, Elder Bradford could not be here. And so we will continue with the three individuals listed on your in your brochures, Elder Isaac Lester, followed by Elder Benjamin Brown, and followed by Elder Dana Edmund. At the request of the family, we request that you try to restrict it as much as possible to 3 minutes. I must warn the preachers that this is not prophetic time. This is three real-time minutes. So as you come, remember to try to stay within those 3 minutes that are given to you. At this time, we will have Elder Isaac Lester, and I will come down to you, Elder, as you speak words of comfort to the family.
I am privileged to be here and have a few words to say because Elder Crowe and I became very special to each other. As we were retired almost at the same time, I think I got to know Fred when I was pastoring here in Riverside. And I tell you that one could have no better friend than Fred Crowe. He was always considerate of other people. He never did do anything that I saw that was unfair, but he was very certain about what he did. And he never did be critical. At least I never saw him critical of anyone. So at the time of my 90th birthday, which is behind me now, I just hope and pray that I can meet Fred Crowe in heaven. And I believe with all of my heart that I will, because he was a man of courage. I'm going to stick close to the limited time, simply because the family is here and you are here. And I must respect the evening hour, because I don't drive normally at night. My vision is not as sharp as it used to be, nor is my walk, as you can see. I cannot walk those stairs. But yet over 40 years ago, I had the distinct privilege of pastoring this church, this congregation. And what an experience it was. Fred moved to the Treasury Department, and I took his place. He pastored Riverside, really. I don't know whether it's in the program or not, but he did pastor Riverside for about I guess 6 months or so. And then with his knowledge of finance, Elder Dudley brought him over to the conference office. And our friendship remained. In fact, it grew deeper. And I can only remember, because when you get an age like I have accumulated by the grace of God, your memory is not as sharp as it used to be. But the one thing I'm thankful for beyond all else is that from the days Fred and I got to really know each other, and that was many of the nearly 45 years I've been in this conference, his memory and mine would get together, and we would recall that this gentleman, to the best of my knowledge, was the first treasurer of a regional conference. You look over the world, he was the first African American. When the conferences were divided, and he did an excellent job. And I want to thank God for the privilege of him calling me sometimes his best friend. Well, I guess I was nearest to him in age, so it would be hard to pick someone else who is young. But there was a lot of young men who were inspired by him. And he had his own quiet humor that kept the congregation laughing. And I appreciate his humor. I don't have humor like he had. But I want to leave you with this word that God called in James, I believe it is. God called Abraham his friend. And I want to stand beside God one day in the kingdom and just say in front of that heavenly host, this gentleman, Lord, as your record indicates, was my dearest friend, and I shall ever remember him as a man of God who appreciated everything that was done to him and for him. And so, by the grace of God, I am thankful to see this wonderful family. And I want you to be faithful, because one day when we get to heaven, you'll see your father, grandfather, whatever relationship you are, I believe you will see Frederick Nathan Crowe. May God bless you, and I'm so proud that his son took such good care of him at the time when he needed it most. I could only get out to visit him every now and then, but he was there regularly. Amen. Thank you so much, Elder, and God bless all of you. And we'll plan to meet Elder Crowe in the kingdom of God.
Amen.
And if I leave, if I leave just a little early, you'll know it's because I have to drive home and it's dark out there. Thank you so much. God bless you all.
Amen.
To the Crowe family, I would just like to encourage you from the Word of God. My mother-in-law, Dr. Mildred Johnson, on her behalf, would like to express to the family her condolences, along with my wife, the lovely lady that just sang the song, Give Me Jesus. They express their condolences to you. Just some words of comfort from the Bible. In John chapter 20, verses 6 and 7. Then cometh Simon Peter, following him, and went into the sepulcher, and seeth the linen clothes lie, and the napkin that was about his head, not lying with the linen clothes, but wrapped together in a place by itself. There's a ministry of the napkin. And that's what I want to just talk about briefly, the ministry of the napkin. I believe Elder Crowe understood the ministry of the napkin. When Peter went into the tomb, he saw the linen clothes lying there, and he saw this napkin that was folded neatly on the side. And there is a message from that napkin that I think is relevant to this experience that we are witnessing here this evening. Every young Jewish boy understood the ministry of the napkin. When the master was at the table, if he finished eating and he wadded up his napkin and dropped it on the table and left the room, that was a sign that he would not be coming back. But with Jesus here in this instance, you notice the napkin is neatly folded and lying on the side. So when the master left the table, if he neatly folded his napkin and left it on the table, the servant knew that he was not supposed to touch the napkin or the table because his master was coming back. So Jesus left this illustration for Elder Crowe and for all of us, that he folded up the napkin. That napkin's message is that I'm coming back. I'm not finished with my work yet, but I'm coming back. So Jesus, I'm so grateful for this example that you left for us, the ministry of the napkin, telling us that you are not finished, but that you are coming back. Elder Crowe realized and recognized that Jesus was not finished when he died and when he rose again. But he will not be finished until he comes back to redeem those who faithfully look for his glorious appearing. May God bless you, Crowe family, and may the napkin continue to minister to you. God bless you.
To the Crowe family, thank you so much for allowing me to be a part of this celebration of the life of a very kind and warm and witty person. Elder Crowe was the treasurer when I came to South Central as a young intern many years ago, and I learned so much from Elder Crowe. One of the things that I learned from Elder Crowe and Elder Dudley was that the workers of South Central came first. No matter what other responsibilities, no matter what meetings he had, and no matter what debts the conference had, when I came to Nashville to serve as youth director, the conference had no money. Mr. President, you think the conference doesn't have any money now. We were positively flush with cash compared to what we were then. Elder Crowe told me that every month, the conference would have to borrow the payroll, and then the next month they would pay it back, and then they would borrow it again, and then pay it again, and borrow it again, and pay it again. But Elder Crowe made sure that no matter who didn't get paid, the workers of South Central got paid. And I'm so appreciative of that. And I learned later that he left some stuff undone when the union, when later on when I became president, the union came to my office one day and said, this is all the money that South Central owes from back in the day. So while I was grateful when I was an intern, I had the responsibility of paying it back when I was president. But he made sure that the workers of the conference were taken care of. And I just appreciate him so very much. Here's where I want to close. I walk. I used to run, but I walk every day now. I try to walk through 3 or 4 miles. And I walk in my neighborhood, and there's a sign there's several dead end streets in my neighborhood, and there's a sign at the end of every dead end. And the sign says that this is the temporary end of the street. And then it goes on to say that this street can be extended by the authority of the Davidson County government. Well, what that says to me is the road has come to the end for our brother, Elder Crowe. But because he believed in Jesus, the road, his life can be extended by the authority of Jesus Christ. And so that's why though we sorrow, we don't sorrow without hope. Because today is not the end of the road for Fred Crowe. And so may the sure promise that we will see Brother Crowe again, may that promise comfort you, family, in the days to come.
At this time, we will have a musical selection by Mrs. Hammond.
Like a river, attend my way. When sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever unbearable it seems.
you're getting the message. It is well with his soul. He trusted, believed in a God who has the authority to extend his life. It is well with his soul. At this time, we will continue with reflections. Persons whose lives have been touched and who will share with us what he meant to them and how he impacted them. And at this time, I will invite Elder Ternia Edwards, followed by Elder Lorenzo Shepherd, and then Elder Alvin Kibble, Vice President of North America Division, to share their reflections on the life of Brother Crowe.
Praise God. Praise God. I have gotten permission, and first of all, I didn't know I was going to be on program, so praise God. Loved Elder Crowe, the many years that he spent at First Church, his faithfulness, his character, his example at First Church was absolutely tremendous, absolutely tremendous. And so I'm going to reflect in the way of a song. One of the dearest things that Elder Crowe said about me at one time, he called me his favorite singer, and hopefully I don't mess that up today, but he called me his favorite singer, and this is one of the songs that he enjoyed that I have sung over the years. I hadn't sung this song in a long time, but we're going to do it tonight. But thank you so much, family. You gave us a warrior. You gave us such an example, loaned him to us for just a little while. And in all the years that he drove up there, and we could see little dings on his car here and there or whatever, we won't talk about that, but all those years that he drove up there, so faithful, so faithful. What a character. I pray that you all would take heed and that we would as well.
Christ alone will our glory, though I could pride myself in battles won. For I've been blessed beyond measure, and by his strength alone I overcome. Oh, I could stop and count successes like diamonds in my hand, but those trophies could not equal to the grace by which I stand. In Christ alone I place my trust and find my glory in the power of the cross. In every glory, let it be said of me, my source of strength and my source of hope is Christ alone. Christ alone will I glory, for only by his grace I am redeemed, and only his tender mercy could reach beyond my weakness to my need. Now I seek no greater honor than just to know him more, and to count my gains but losses to the glory. ray of my Lord. In Christ alone I place my trust and find my glory in the power of the cross. In every victory, let it be said of me, my source of strength and my source of hope is Christ alone. I place my trust and find my glory in the power of the cross. In every victory, let it be said of me, my source of strength and my source of hope is Christ alone. My source of strength and my source of hope is Christ alone. Hallelujah.
In 1982, I began my ministry here in South Central Conference, and Elder Crowe was my first treasurer. In 2006, I became his pastor at the Springfield First Church. But for the past 4 years, for the past 4 years, Elder Crowe became my friend. And for the past 4 years, we had a tradition, Ronnie, of watching the Super Bowl together. And Ronnie, I looked at the 2019 schedule, and the Super Bowl is February the 3rd. And since your dad won't be here, I'll have to come to Chicago and watch the game with you. Are you be here? Okay, all right. Well, since you'll be here, after the Cowboys win the Super Bowl, I'm going to take you out to a restaurant, and Sharon, I won't keep him out too late because I know at his age, he doesn't get out late. I also had a tradition, tried to make a tradition to take Elder Crowe out to eat, and I took him to Piccadilly's, and I was amazed that he had never even heard of Piccadilly's, and he really enjoyed the food. And when we told the lady at the restaurant that he was 103, she said, the next time you come to Piccadilly's, I will pay for your dinner. And so we came back next week, and sure enough, the waitress, right, I feel kind of bad because, you know, they don't make much money, but she went into her little pocketbook, her little tip money, and she went. And she paid for Elder Crowe's meal. And while we were at Piccadilly's, an elderly lady walked up behind me. She put her hands on my shoulder, Ronnie, and she said, "You are so blessed to have your father here and to be able to sit here." I didn't tell any different, but for another reason, because Elder Crowe was a father to me. And Elder Crowe was instrumental in encouraging my son to pick the college of his choice. Benjamin made the mistake of telling Elder Crowe that he had Andrews and Oakwood on his short list. And Elder Crowe said, "Benjamin, why do you want, you don't want to go up there?" He said, "You need to go to Oakwood." And every time Benjamin came around, he gave Benjamin a sermon on the mount as to why he needed to go to Oakwood. And so Benjamin is now at Oakwood. He's a junior studying occupational therapy. And as I got closer to Elder Crowe, I learned something that I didn't know. Elder Crowe loved wrestling. I mean, he would watch wrestling for 3 hours on Monday night and Tuesday night. And so I told Ronnie the other day, I said, "Ronnie, I'm so impressed with your dad. He knows all the names of the wrestlers." And Ronnie said, "Shepherd, I'm disappointed in you." He said, "Why would you be impressed with that?" He said, "You would know all the wrestlers too if you watched them for 6 hours once a week." And I never forget, while Elder Crowe was getting older, he couldn't remember the days of the week. And it was a Monday night, and Ronnie and I, we wanted to watch Monday night football. And so Elder Crowe, he didn't know what day it was, so we had Monday night football on, and Philip came over. And Philip was like, "Grandpa, why don't you watch a wrestling night?" And Ronnie said what I was thinking. I was like, Ronnie said, "Philip, why did you remind him what night it was?" Well, we watched football that night. But I want to say in closing that if you were to ask Elder Crowe why he lived so long, he would tell you about his diet. But the last thing he would say, he said, "I honored the fifth commandment." He said, "I took care of my father in his old age." And he said, "Because of that, God has given me long life." And Ronnie, you've done the same thing. God bless you, my brother.
Ronnie, Sharon, there's a lot that I could say, but I know the time is short, and I'm not known for short speeches. I met your father 67 years ago when my dad returned to the Lake Region Conference, where he had already pastored, to serve as president. And you and I became the best of friends. We lived within a few feet of each other. And it seemed like every day we spent in one another's home. Every holiday we spent in each other's home. You, along with Donnie and then Robert. And there's much that could be said about friendship. But I can say that although we have had very little contact with each other over most of our adult lives, when you called just a few days ago, it was as if we had just spoken the week before. 67 years is a long time. I can remember your dad in the way in which he engaged with little children way back then. It was not an exception, but he found children to be important, and he would engage with them, as I am sure he did with your grandchildren. I found him to be an individual who had incredible resilience. I do leadership training, coaching, and development for executive leaders in the North American division. And one of the core competencies is being resilient. I watched that in your dad. I learned that in your dad. We don't get a chance to pick our crisis or our storms, but they do shape our tenure of leadership. One of the other things that I observed about him was his consistency. He was consistent in who he was, no matter where he was, because he had what Stephen Covey calls responsibility. He knew how to respond rather than being programmed based on how somebody else was relating to him. He had this deep-founded commitment to a cause. And he didn't question about who he was. He knew he was Frederick Nathan Crowe. And he realized that it may not mean anything to you, but it meant something to God. Oh, I could just go on and on. I came down to interview him 2 years ago, and we sat there in his home, and he began to engage in conversation with things that had happened over 60 years ago, but it was as if it just happened yesterday. He shared with me how when he was negotiating on purchasing the campground up in Cassopolis, he went up and there was a Jewish man that owned the property, and he asked him, well, what are you offering? He said, $25,000. He said, you act like you want it for free. He said, that would be nice. So many, many things. I can't go on. It's just impossible to capture all of that. But on behalf of the North American Division of Seventh-day Adventists, on behalf of our president, Elder Daniel L. Jackson, our secretary, Elder G. Alexander Bryant, and our treasurer, Elder Tom Evans, we would like to extend our most warmest greetings to you in honor of your dad, who is one of the living legends of this church. The Bible talks about men of valor. Your dad, your grandfather, he was a man of valor. And he set his own standard. And we're still trying to fill those giant shoes. So our hearts go out to you, but in celebration, not in mourning, because he lived his life. He lived it in such a way that we are still inspired today by the things he said and did. Jesus said to his disciples on one crisis moment, he said, don't let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, don't you? He said, believe also in me. Because in my Father's house are many mansions. If it weren't so, I would have told you, I'm going to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will, not shall, not could, not might, I will come again to receive you unto myself. This ain't the end, folk. That where I am, ye may be also. Wherefore, he said, wherefore, comfort one another with these words. And I maintain that the future is always as bright as the promises of God. God bless you.
I stand here this evening representing the regional officer group and the regional black caucus. We walk along the trails blazed by men like Elder Fred Crowe. One of the interview questions that I would ask potential hires, especially those from Oakwood and from Andrews, I would ask them, who influenced you to want to be an Adventist minister? Who influenced you to want to be a teacher or literature evangelist or a treasurer? Who influenced your preaching, your management style, your canvas? And up until maybe a decade and a half ago, it would be an Adventist pastor, an Adventist teacher. Now you're likely to get an answer of some TV evangelist or some author who wants to pour into you. It used to be Charles Bradford. It used to be E.E. Cleveland. It used to be C.D. Brooks. Those were our idols. Those were the people that we fashioned ourselves after. But something has happened in our church where those whom we idolize, and I idolize these men. When I came into the work, I just, whenever I was in their presence, it was like an awe moment. But we have other heroes now. We have other idols. We have other people we try to emulate. Let me tell you something. The Charles Dudleys of the world and the T. Marshall Kellys of the world and the Fred Crowes and the Mildred Johnsons did more for the spiritual life of people than this world will ever know. And we have failed, sadly. I have failed. In making sure that the generation that sits across from us who will inherit this church when we're all gone, if the Lord has not come, that they know the people who blaze the trails. Somehow we got to fix that. And maybe the publishing people can get some tracks with Fred Crowe's face on us. Maybe y'all need to work on that. It's your idea, not mine. It's your idea. Do that. So that the school kids can know it. So that especially the preachers and teachers out of Oakwood at least know who led this work. In honor of Elder Crowe's service as a treasurer, I think we have 5 of the 9 regional treasurers. Do we have, am I correct tonight? Philip. Philip is going to speak in a little bit. My treasure is, did Makita make it? Makita? Please, all the treasures, please stay. Sonia Creighton, Yvonne Collins from Lake Region. Jermaine Jackson from Allegheny. The treasurers made sure that they were here tonight to honor Elder Crowe. Thank you for being here. Thank you for the work that you do. And we thank Elder Crowe's family. Allowing this church to benefit from what he has done. We need to teach these things to our children and to our grandchildren. It would be a shame, a crying shame, if another generation of Adventists come who do not know the names of those who blazed the trails. That's on me. That's on you. Let's see if we can fix that. I'll say this in closing. I know my 3 minutes are up. We're building a facility on the campus of Oakwood University. Not a little house on the prairie. We're building a building right beside the McKee building to house a regional work, Breath of Life, Message Magazine, and we will have a historical room in there to honor those who have work in the heat of the day in this work. We're accepting contributions. We're building a $6 million edifice. We're not building a double wide. We're building a facility that will represent the regional work. Help us if you can.
Thank you, Elder Winston. At this time, we want to invite Dr. Summerwood to give us our special news.
Even failed to believe, yet he's been
Aren't we glad to know that God is faithful? He's faithful. And he was faithful to your dad, Ron, and he'll be faithful to you, to all your family. At this time, we will continue our reflections with Elder Philip Palmer, Treasurer of Southwest Region Conference of Seventh-day Adventists.
Thank you, Ellen. Reflections. First of all, thank you, Ronnie. I appreciate it. I'm not a man for speeches. So when I called you the other evening, I really didn't expect to be a participant. I just wanted to stand and provide support. But I'm grateful for the opportunity to come and say a few words of reflection. I've jotted mine down to make sure that I stay within the time. First of all, I stand to represent, of course, my family, my wife, Ingrid. Couldn't be with us this evening, but she sends her love and her prayers and condolence. Sister Crowe and Ella Crowe were very supportive to us as we served with South Central Conference. Also, I'm standing as a member of the Regional Conference Treasurers. As was mentioned before, and I'm going to ask them to stand again, all of the regional conference treasurers that have joined us, there are five of us that are here this evening, two of which followed me here at South Central Conference. And then from Lake Region Conference, we have Yvonne Collins and Jermaine Jackson from Allegheny West. So we're going to ask them to stand. We communicate via text. And so we wanted to make sure that we stood in support. So we want to make sure that you understood that. Thank you so much. Lastly, I'm a former treasurer of South Central Conference. My first encounter with Elder Crowe was as a summer auditor intern from Oakwood College. Green with book knowledge, but not a whole lot of experience. And my auditing partner for two summers was Seth Bardu. Seth is also a former treasurer of South Central Conference, who sends his prayers and support to the family. Elder Crowe was very gracious and kind to us as he shared with us the various working papers and gave us an assignment. Elder Crowe set a very clear, conservative travel budget for us, which made for some interesting times and experiences as we crisscrossed this wonderful territory. But while we traveled, we learned a great deal. We learned how to navigate and set our schedule and communicate and get to know so many great people here. Elder Crowe was always supportive and encouraging, and whenever we would return to do reports, after a few days he would ask us, "Did you bring back any checks, brothers?" He would say with that ring in his voice. Later, I was hired by South Central Conference and started in the ABC with Laureen Brown, and then later began to serve in the Treasury Department. So Elder Crowe was my first Treasury boss. He was not one who gave constant instruction, but I learned by observing from him how a successful treasurer functions. He loved Sister Crowe, and she loved him. That was unmistakable. In South Central, and probably in other conferences, we were notorious for having various meetings that would last long into the afternoon. But around 2 or 3 in the afternoon, Sister Crowe would call because they had some lunch appointment or some other appointment. And that was the end of the meeting. I believe some thought or joked that Elder Crowe had arranged these calls so he could get out of the meeting. Treasure lesson number one, conference business is important. Family is more important. Conference business can be crazy, dealing with the saints, challenging and working with fellow officers and staff, handling the stress of supporting ministry and navigating vision despite limited resources. During my years of working for and with Elder Crowe, I never observed him out of control. Enraged, mad, vengeful, etc. His personality and practice was always even-tempered. Treasure lesson number two. There has got to be at least one cool head in the officer group. No doubt, tests will come from many angles, but the treasurer must operate with an even keel above the fray. Elder Crowe was also a faithful member of the First SDA Church in Springfield, Tennessee. He supported the young people. He was actively involved in the church of that ministry. Treasurer lesson number three, actively support local church ministry. Learn to understand the needs of the local congregation firsthand. While there was quite a generational gap, Elder Crowe allowed us to Earlene Madison, Jimmy Shelton, Veronica Luckett, and Seth Bardu, his staff, to innovate and improve on the practices, procedures, and policies of Treasury. Treasurer lesson number four, encourage growth within your staff. Elder Crowe loved to play tennis, and he was pretty good at it. Treasure lesson number five, stay physically active. Have an interest or hobby outside of and different from treasury work. Finally, even after he was retired, Elder Crowe actively participated as a member of our supplemental retirement board. He carefully watched our funds performance and gave guidance to us as we managed the funds and kept us on our toes as we provided regular reports to the board. Treasurer lesson number six, find different ways to serve the body of Christ. So, while I didn't take a class from the good elder, in reflection, I learned a great deal from him. Those lessons I have put into practice and shared with those who have followed me in service. Elder Crowe's service in the ministry of treasury was a personal blessing to me. To the staffs that he led, and to the larger community of the regional conference treasurers, I stand this evening to honor and testify to the blessing of his service. We pray that our Heavenly Father will comfort you as you take a while to mourn the loss of him, and then take a lifetime to rejoice and be encouraged by your memories of him and the blessing of the life of service he led. Family, thank you.
Our next speaker would be Elder Joseph McCoy, Executive Director of Regional Conference Retirement Plan, former president of South Central Conference of Seventh-day Adventists. And then after his reflection, Mr. Irving Vandenberg, cousin, representative family, will give his reflection.
Everyone stayed within the time. And since I'm the last one, one would believe and know that everything has been said, so that all I need to do is say ditto and sit down, but I'm not. I had the privilege of becoming the first secretary for South Central Conference prior to that, we always had a secretary treasurer. So that when I became secretary of the conference, I relieved Elder Crowe of half of his duties. He was not mad about it. If I were to say something, and there are a lot of things that could be said about Elder Crowe, but the one thing that I hope all of us will remember is this man has been a witness to a century. 100 years he has witnessed. And I liked about him that he was fair and balanced and practical. Those things that upset us, what we should wear, what we should eat, Elder Crowe did not get ruffled by that, but he was a steady Christian person who walked whatever this church believed was what our membership should do. He did it. I like the fact that he never considered himself to be old. We were in Murfreesboro, Tennessee one time, and he had been invited to speak for a Senior Citizens Day, Ron. And when he stood there, you know, Elder Crowe would say whatever was on his mind. I mean, he didn't care. So he said, I'm happy to be here today to preach. He said, but I don't know why you called me for a Senior Citizens Day. Elder Crowe gave medical advice to men. He told us, gentlemen, if you want to be good a long time, eat pumpkin seeds. He was a medical advisor. More than being a Seventh-day Adventist Christian, Elder Crowe was a Christian Seventh-day Adventist. Christian came first. Not ostentatious at all, just steady in his walk with the Lord and the example that he set for us. I talked to one of my daughters in the last 2 minutes of my 3-minute speech. She told me, and I, you know, we were talking about Elder Crowe as I drove up from Huntsville today. And she said, you know what impressed me about Elder Crowe? I said, what is that? She said, I hadn't seen him in about 15 years. And I rushed up to him to say hello, Elder Crowe, and tell him my name. And he said, I know who you are, Meredith. So he knew people. He knew young people, he knew their names, and that was, of course, very important. So, a witness to a century. Every ministry has crises. Am I right or wrong? I know you have to play like you didn't have any in your ministry. But we had a crisis in our conference at one time. And the president was worried about the people that were causing the trouble. And it was very serious trouble that could have destroyed this conference, seriously. And while the president was upset, Elder Crowe, in his very practical ways, because the president was worried about where these people were going to go, how they were going to make it, Elder Crowe said, don't worry about it, Chief. They'll be here before payday. And sure enough, the day before payday, they were all lined up in the conference office looking for their checks. Ecclesiastes 10:19, is it? Says that money answereth all things. Elder Crowe recited that many, many times. money answereth all things. So that when these people were lined up after having caused all this turbulence, they were there for their check. Elder Crowe told me, he said, I told you they would be here. Money answereth all things. I will not forget him because of his steadiness. He was a devoted Christian with his mind on Jesus and his feet on the ground, always practical in his walk. And so it's my honor to stand here today to represent my family, to represent the retirement community from the Seventh-day Adventist Church and the regional conferences, and remind us that we must never forget this day, because this man, the end of this man's life, is the end of an era. An end of an era. If I'm remembering correctly, he's the last one of those leaders that started regional conferences back in 1944. Finally, and maybe I should have ended on that note, but I have to tell you this. We did a video of Elder Crowe when he turned 100. And the gentleman who was quizzing him said, Elder Crowe, I understand are you still driving? He said, why, yes. How can a man get around without driving? And he was 100 years old. He wasn't playing. So he started to talk about some of the historical occurrences in our church, and when black people couldn't hold certain positions, they would put white people in charge of it who didn't know what the job was. So the tape was running, and Elder Crowe got wound up in it, and he said, they put so-and-so in front of here. He was dumb and stupid. And then he said, and then they sent another one. And he was stupid too. Then he said, oh, can I say that? He wanted to wipe it out. Through all of this, we stand with these memories in our heads and in our hearts. And we say to this entire family, you're not going through this period by yourself. It may not be expressed the way it hits you because he was flesh and blood. But understand, you don't walk by yourself. And the Lord has sent us here so that you could see our faces and etch them in your minds. They will play back to you as the days unfold to make the day brighter and the walk straighter. God bless you during this particular period as we celebrate the life of this great man.
On behalf of the family, I'd like to express our appreciation for the wonderful music that we've experienced this evening, and also for the very kind words coming from the friends and acquaintances, folks that have known my uncle all these years. You call him Elder Crowe. The family call him either Dad or Grandpa. I call him Uncle Fred. And all my friends that knew me referred to him as Uncle Fred. He was first introduced to this message when he was a child playing in the streets of West Oakland. And Hanson Mitchell and P.W. Ridgway came to West Oakland and started a branch Sabbath school. And my grandmother, Uncle Fred's mother, and my mother and were baptized into this truth, along with his good friend, Gordon Battles. And he went on to go on through, he went to school at Golden Gate Academy, and that was a school where my mother and my father, my uncles on both sides of the family went through. And when he went to, as he became a minister, and he was there in Chicago, each year they would be, about every other year they would come to California. My Uncle Fred and Walter Kazak and his family. And it was like a high day there at Market Street Church that the sons were coming back. And they would put on a wonderful program for us. My Aunt Rosetta would sing, and it was just a wonderful experience. For those of you that are not familiar with Northern California, the Market Street Church was the mother church of all the black churches in Northern California. In fact, the current pastor of the church is Pastor Edwin Brown, who came from this conference. There are some stories I'd like to tell about my uncle. But first, before I get to that, I want to really acknowledge my cousin, Ronald. He's the only son left now. And you are now the, you're the head of the family. No, I won't say it, old man, you're younger than me. But, you are the head of the family, and they'll be looking to you for guidance. And my prayer is that, you know, you will stand firm. You will continue to give good advice. I mean, I've witnessed you this past week with your family, and it's just wonderful. I see that they have all are doing well. And what we want to do is make sure that this experience that you've had with Dad, that it does not end here, but that we all meet on the sea of glass and enjoy eternity forever. My father had a boat club, and he asked my uncle, they were about 15 at the time, and my uncle, who would become my father's brother-in-law, to be the treasurer. And when they got enough money together, the group of boys would go to San Francisco. Now, there was no bridge in those days. They would have to ride the ferry. And they get over to the amusement park. And Uncle Fred would walk around with his hands in his pocket. And my dad and all of his friends would get on all the rides and have a good time. At the end of the day, they'd have to get back over to the Oakland side. Well, it takes money to get back over there. And they have no money. And Uncle Fred, he had not spent anything. He'd walked around with a smile on his face. Now, this story comes to me from my father. They said it didn't happen once, but had several times. So he would loan them money to get back home, but they had to pay back with interest, you know. And it happened. So, the last time I was here visiting him, I asked him. I said, "Uncle, I said, why'd you do my dad that way?" And he said, "Well, I walked around smiling." I said, "I knew I was going to make some money." You know, so that was the start of his interest in money matters. I'd like to share with you. I lost the text. Well, anyway, it's out of First Thessalonians 4, 15, 16. Says that the Lord Himself would descend with a shout, with the trump of God, with the voice of an archangel. It says the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up into the air to be to enjoy an eternity with Him forever. and so shall we ever be with the Lord. It says that we are to comfort one another with these words. And so I leave this with the family, that you have been privileged to have had such a great man in your life. And I can see the influence already in your lives. So whatever you do from here on, just keep that in mind, that you want to do everything that will honor his memory. Keep doing what you're doing. And God bless you. Thank you.
We shall now have a musical selection by the First Lady of Riverside Chapel, Sister Jennifer Fordham, wife of Pastor Furman Fordham, our senior pastor. That will be followed by the eulogy by Dr. Roy Gator, and then benediction by Elder Benjamin Brown.
precious Lord.
Lord, we've come to give you praises. You alone are worthy to be praised. We have come to magnify you. You alone are worthy to be praised. Our God is a good God. Even in times like these, He's a good God. It has been my privilege to be the pastor of Elder Crowe for about 6 years. And I can honestly say I'm going to miss him. Missing him already. I can remember the times when we would have fellowship dinner. Elder Crowe and I would sit together every fellowship dinner. And he would pour into me all of these stories of his life. I can't share all of those stories with you today, tonight. But I do want to say there's a person, two persons in here that I think we need to honor. And the first one is Ron Crowe's wife. And the reason we need to honor her is because she permitted her husband to come down and take care of Elder Crowe. And I think she needs to be honored for that. Amen. Then the second person is Ron Crowe himself. Because as many of you know, he lives in Chicago. But he knew his dad needed him. And he came down to spend many days with his dad. And he needs to be honored for being a great son. I want to thank those who are members of the Springfield Church. Would you stand, those of you who help take care of Elder Crowe weekend? All of these, those who are standing, these are the members of the Springfield Church. Thank you so much for being so kind and so gracious. This is a wonderful, wonderful church. Ron, we're going to try to wrap it up. Let's pray. Father, we thank you so much for your goodness and your grace today.
be with us, dear Lord, at this moment, in Jesus' name, amen. 2 Timothy chapter 4, 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 9, and it says simply, do thy diligence to come shortly unto me. Then verse 21, do thy diligence to come before winter. I want to talk a little bit about come before winter. In the context of 2 Timothy 4, we find Paul at the end of his life. Paul is writing to Timothy what is considered by some to be his last letter. The letter appears to be a farewell letter to Timothy, but Paul, in an insistent way, petitions Timothy to come to him. Perhaps Paul wanted to share with Timothy things relating to the care of the churches. In addition, it is fair to say that Paul wanted Timothy to come as a source of comfort. In the things concerning the church, Paul admonishes Timothy to preach the word. Why, you may ask? Because the time would come when people would not endure sound teaching. Paul told Timothy in his letter, God will judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. As much as we try to ignore it, there is a judgment to come for all of us. But if we confess our sins, the Bible says, he is faithful and just to forgive us. There's good news coming from God. In the book of Jeremiah 18 and verse 7 and 8, there is a saying, a rendition like this. What he says he will do in judgment, if we turn from evil, he will end up not doing on account of his mercy. That is a wonderful, wonderful text. Paul knew that he was dying. I believe that Elder Crowe, like Paul, knew he was on the borders of death. He knew he didn't have long to live, but he loved life. Elder Crowe, some of you may not know, had an operation, an open heart operation, when he was around 100. 100. And he survived. He loved living. Paul says in 2 Timothy 4 and verse 6, for I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. Here lies the basis for Paul to tell Timothy, come. Come before winter. Because my time is up. I'm ready to be offered. You see, when you reach the age of 100, you know the time of your departure is at hand.
Elder Crowe was full of life. But the time of his offering was coming to an end. And yours and mine are coming to an end. This process of dying begins when we start living. And our time is getting short. He understood that with time, there are things that happen to us. Alistair Begg terms three things that happens to us as we get older. We diminish. We know we are getting old. Even if we're 30, we know we are getting old. In fact, I'm finding out more and more that this process is happening in my life. It is so hard to get on the floor and get back up. Some of you know what I'm talking about. We ache and we hurt. This process, this diminishing process, is taking place right now. Now, Elder Crowe was driving at a late age, even at 103. And the reason I know, as pastor of the church, I would see Elder Crowe at church and Ron did not bring him. And I knew that Elder Crowe drove to church. That frightened me. 103. Now, I told this before, but one day Elder Crowe came to church and I said, "Elder Crowe, I'd like to follow you home." And he said, "Sure, Pastor, just follow me." And so I got in my car, he got in his car, and Elder Crowe was driving, and I kid you not, honestly, I told this before, the speed limit was 55. Elder Crowe was going 67 miles per hour. He left me. He left me. Frightening. One of the other things that happens to us when we get older, we become disoriented. You know what I'm talking about. You're upstairs and you go downstairs to get something and you don't know why you went downstairs. So you have to go back upstairs to think about why you can't. You understand. That happens to us as we get older. In fact, yesterday, my wife is a witness, I was hanging up some of my clothes. And as I was hanging up some of my clothes, I had an ink pen in my pocket. And I took the ink pen out, and for some reason, I went to the closet and tried to hang my ink pen on a clothes hanger. That happens when you're getting older. You become disoriented. And she would never know, and you would never know anything about this, but I decided to tell her that's what happens as you get older. Then we began to reminisce. Alistair Begg says we began to reminisce and tell of the moments of our lives. And so we began to talk about things. Paul is there in Rome. He's weak. He is susceptible. He was disappointed by Demas that left him for the world. And he says, no one was here to stand with me, to be with me. Only Luke is with me. You know, it's hard to lose a colleague. Some of you don't know, but Elder Crowe was my pastor here at Riverside. And then I became his pastor. I was his Timothy as he poured into me things about life, things about ministry, how to love the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul knew what it was like to be cold and lonely. Alistair Begg talks about this book that David Brooks wrote, that in this time of life, you begin to reminisce and you think about things. You think about people that you love and people that didn't love you and people who did things to you. And you would discover that Paul was no different in 2 Timothy chapter 4. Paul started talking about Demas. And then he said, Luke was with me. And then he said, bring Mark. He was useful for me. Before, as you know, Mark was useless. I remember Elder Crowe was one of our elders, and we would put his name on the bulletin. You know, we wanted to make sure that Elder Crowe was included. And I remember he and his wife were sitting down, and you know how we do as ministers. If you're going to be on the pulpit, you would need to come to the office, and, you know, you get your assignment and so forth, and everybody would know what they're doing. And I noticed Elder Crowe didn't come. So I walked out, and I saw him there. He was sitting with his wife, and I said, Elder Crowe, you going to serve with us today? And Elder Crowe said, no, Pastor, I'm not going to come today. I just want to sit right here and rub my wife's legs. I kid you not, I wouldn't make this up. He said that. He did. He said that. I just turned my head and I went on back to the pastor's study. Elder Crowe was useless to us. He never did serve once again with us as we did. He was useless. Paul said, Alexander the coppersmith did me much evil. He's reminiscing of things that happened in his life. He did me much evil. You would think that Paul was a bitter old man if that was the conclusion of his writing. If it stopped there, Paul would have been a bitter old man. He had these thoughts and these feelings about people that hurt him, but that's not where it ended. Paul goes on to talk about something else. Paul goes on to say, I pray God that it may not be laid to their charge. Paul came around to forgive those who did evil to him. Don't lay it at their charge. So Paul tells us all, even today, come before winter. You may have something that you need to get right with someone. Come before winter. Come and get your sins forgiven. You may have meant it for evil, but God meant it for good. Paul goes on to say that he was strengthened, that God strengthened him. And he says that I was delivered out of the mouth of the lions. God delivered him out of the mouth of the lions. He was strengthened. Strengthened. And then in 18, verse 18, and it says, and the Lord shall deliver me from every evil. He will preserve me until his heavenly kingdom. And then he started doing something that every Christian is going to get a chance to do. He started worshiping. Oh, he started worshiping in this verse. You see, I was reading in the Sabbath school lesson this week that everything in heaven and everything on earth and everything under the earth in the waters will praise God for who he is and what he's done. He's been a good God to die for us and forgive us and allow us into his heavenly kingdom. And one of these days he's going to prepare a table for us. The Bible says that I tell you the truth. He himself will seat them. And then the Bible says that he's going to put on a garment. And then he's going to serve us. It's unbelievable. God serving us. Incredible. Can you see Jesus putting on an apron? Anything else you need? Is there something you want? I'm going to serve you. That's why we're going to praise him. That's why we're going to say he's worthy. But you've got to come before winter. Because if you don't come before winter, you will never have this privilege of praising God, worshiping God, for he's worthy to be praised. May God bless all of us as we worship him and praise his holy name.
I want to thank Dr. Gator for that word. Before we have our benediction, I want to make one last presentation. I'm going to ask Dr. Grider to come and make the presentation for us on behalf of the Southern Union and the South Central Conference.
We want to ask all the workers South Central or denominational workers to stand at this time with me, please. On behalf of these individuals standing before you, Elder Crowe's family, we would like to present you with something not only from South Central but from us. This medallion we want to present, recognizing the ministry, the service that Elder Crowe has given to all of us, not just the regional conferences, but across the entire world. We give it to you, letting you know that we love you for giving him to us, for the years that he served our churches, our schools, and our departments across this country. We leave this with you so that you can take it and put it with him. God bless you. May he give you peace. And let's be ready when Jesus shall come in a few years.
Family can remain seated, but we'd like to ask everyone else to please stand for the benediction. Our Father in heaven, we recognize that life is a gift from you, not to be used as we see fit, but to be used as you see fit. So we thank you for the gift of life that you entrusted to Elder Fred Crowe, for the fact that he gave that gift of life back to you in service. May we duplicate that example in our individual lives and experiences. And Lord, we pray that we thank you for your great love for us. Lord, when I look at your great love for me and I examine my love for you, there's no comparison. Lord, when I look at the sacrifices that you have made for us and for me, my sacrifice seems like nothing at all. Lord, when I look at your great mercy that you have extended to me, help me to be merciful to each person with whom I come in contact. Thank you again. Bless this family. Do that unique and special thing for them that only divinity can do for humanity. And as Christ is intervening and interceding in heaven, intervene in this family and may they realize the presence of the Creator, the Almighty God, our Redeemer. Bless them and keep them and shield them from the darts that the enemy might cast in their direction. Bless them and console them as only you can. Take us all home safely. Grant us the privilege to worship you again at the proper time. In Jesus' name I pray. Let everyone say amen, amen, and amen.
We ask that the congregation remain seated reverently as we have our recession. The platform personnel and the family, accompanied by the casket, be removed. We ask that you remain seated until it is finished.